At 9:01 p.m. on January the 3rd, 1961, alarm bells began clanging in the communications center of the Atomic Energy Commission's National Reactor Testing Station, which was 60 kilometers outside of Idaho Falls. The alert was coming from SL-1, one of many experimental nuclear reactors in operation around the site. The controller on duty tried to contact the three-man night shift on the telephone. When no one answered, however, he dispatched firefighters from two local fire stations to investigate. When the team arrived at the fenced-in SL-1 compound, everything appeared normal, with no sign of fire, smoke, or steam. Nonetheless, the firefighters unlocked the gates and proceeded into the reactor building. Again, everything seemed quiet. However, the control room was empty, with no sign of the reactor crew. But when the firefighters approached the reactor room itself, their radiation counters began to chatter, the needle swinging past 25 Röntgens per hour. The radiation soon grew so intense that the team was forced to withdraw, but a brief glance into the reactor room confirmed the worst. SL-1 had suffered a catastrophic explosion. By the next day, three men would be found dead and SL-1 completely destroyed in America's first, and thus far only, fatal reactor accident. So what happened? The National Reactor Testing Station, today the Department of Energy's Idaho National Laboratory, was established by the Atomic Energy Commission, or AEC, in 1949. The 2,000 square kilometer site was selected due to its remote location far from any large civilian settlements, allowing new and potentially dangerous reactor designs to be tested in relative safety. As such, the NRTS has been the site of many nuclear energy firsts. For example, on December the 20th, 1951, the experimental breeder reaction number 1, or EBR-1, became the first nuclear reactor in history to generate usable electrical power, illuminating 4 200-watt light bulbs. It later generated enough energy to run all its buildings' lights and other systems. 4 years later, on July 17th, 1955, the town of Arco, Idaho became the first community in the world to be powered entirely by nuclear power, supplied by the Borax 3 reactor. The first reactor to supply electricity to a power grid, however, was the Obninsk nuclear power plant in the Soviet Union, which was connected in June of 1954. The NRTS also developed the reactors used in the USS Nautilus, the world's first nuclear power submarine, and in the aircraft nuclear propulsion project. In the late 1950s, the US military was engaged in the construction of the Distant Early Warning, or DEW line, a chain of radar stations stretching across northern Canada, Alaska, Greenland, and Iceland. The DEW line was designed to detect Soviet nuclear bombers approaching over the North Pole and give American and Canadian interceptor fighters and missiles sufficient time to be scrambled. However, keeping these massive installations supplied with electricity and heat in the middle of the Arctic tundra proved challenging. So in 1955, the Army Reactors Branch issued a request for a compact, low-powered nuclear reactor suitable for use in remote areas. The Army's specifications called for a reactor whose components could be easily transported by existing cargo aircraft, required minimal on-site construction and maintenance, and could operate continuously for 3 years without refueling. While most reactors at the time were embedded in the ground for shielding and safety reasons, the Arctic permafrost made this impossible, so the reactor had to be assembled entirely above ground. The task of designing the new reactor was given to the AEC's Argonne National Laboratory in Lamont, Illinois. The prototype was initially designated the Argonne Low Power Reactor, or ALPR, but this was later changed to the Stationary Low Power Reactor 1, or SL-1 for short. As per the Army's request, SL-1 was designed to be as simple and robust as possible. The core was composed of a square grid of 48 rectangular fuel elements composed of 93% enriched uranium, between which fit 5 38-kilogram cruciform control rods made of neutron-absorbing cadmium, which could be slid vertically in and out of the core to control the rate of the reaction. The highly enriched fuel allowed the reactor to operate for 3 years on a single load, while the small number of control rods was designed to simplify construction and maintenance. However, this had the side effect of giving the reactor a large amount of excess reactivity and increasing its sensitivity to even small control rod movements, design flaws which were soon to prove deadly. SL-1 was also one of the world's first boiling water reactors, or BWRs, in which the light water coolant is boiled in the core and the resulting steam passed directly through turbines to generate electricity. This eliminated the need for the heavy and complex pressurized water loops and heat exchangers found in more conventional pressurized water reactors, or PWRs. The small size of the core also allowed SL-1 to be cooled by natural thermal convection, with no need for pumps to circulate the coolant through the core. The reactor had a peak output of 2 megawatts and could generate 200 kilowatts of electricity and 400 kilowatts of thermal energy for space heating. SL-1 was installed at the NRTS between 1957 and 1958, first achieving criticality on August 11, 1958. The reactor was contained in a cylindrical sheet metal structure 11.5 meters in diameter and 14.5 meters tall, surrounded by various support and administration buildings. Unlike in most reactors, the enclosure was not designed to contain the force of an explosion or radioactive debris in the case of an accident. This was because SL-1 was designed for use in remote areas where the construction of heavy concrete containment vessels would not be possible. Going back to the explosion, on February 5, 1959, SL-1 was handed over to Combustion Engineering, Inc., a New York-based civilian contractor. CE not only managed the day-to-day operation of the reactor, but also the training and certification of both civilian and military reactor operators. SL-1 was operated around the clock in 3 8-hour shifts, but due to a lack of funds from the AEC, only the day shift could be fully staffed, with the night shift being staffed by a 3-man crew consisting of a supervisor, an operator, and a trainee. By the time of the 1961 accident, SL-1 had been running for 2.5 years, generating a total of 931.5 megawatt days with no major incidents. But on December the 21st, 1960, the reactor was shut down for routine maintenance and minor modification, with startup scheduled for the following month. At 4 p.m. on January the 3rd, 1961, the day shift departed and was replaced by a 3-man night shift composed of 26-year-old Navy Construction Electrician First Class Richard C. Legg, 27-year-old Army Specialist John A. Burns, and 22-year-old Army Specialist Richard L. McKinley. Legg acted as shift supervisor and Burns as reactor operator, while McKinley was a trainee scheduled to be certified the following month. The trio were given a long list of tasks to complete in order to prepare the reactor for startup, including partially draining the core of coolant, reinstalling the shield plugs at the top of the reactor pressure vessel, and reconnecting the control rods to their electric drive motors. It was during the latter task that the deadly explosion occurred, with thermal sensors in the building triggering the alarm in the communications center. Going back to the rescue crew, upon entering the reactor building, the first rescue crews discovered the bodies of Burns and McKinley on the ground floor, surrounded by rubble. Burns was dead, his heart pierced by a broken rib. McKinley was alive but unconscious, though he succumbed to his injuries 2 hours later. Richard Legg, however, was nowhere to be found. It was not until several hours later that his body was finally discovered, impaled to the ceiling by one of the heavy shield plugs from the top of the reactor. Unfortunately, radiation levels were so high, nearly 1,000 Röntgens near the ceiling, that recovering Legg's body from below proved impossible. Instead, a special chemical radiological unit from Dugway Proving Ground, Utah, rigged a special metal arm to the end of a boom crane and used it to slide open the large freight door on the second story of the reactor building. Internal structures and debris blocked access to the body and had to be cut away, a task performed by a welder inside a lead-shielded box attached to the crane. Finally, a special stretcher was attached to the crane and, on January the 9th, 2-man relays of rescuers ran up the arm into the building and used long pole-mounted hooks to dislodge Legg's body and drop it into the stretcher. This procedure was fraught with danger, for it was feared that if the shield plug, which had impaled Legg, fell from the ceiling, it could impact the reactor and potentially start a new chain reaction. To minimize radiation exposure, the rescuers practiced the procedure repeatedly using a mock-up of the SL-1 building and were limited to shifts of only 65 seconds. Once free, Legg's body was placed in a lead-lined cask and whisked away for decontamination and autopsy. With the crew's bodies recovered, the investigation of the accident itself commenced. A television camera mounted to the end of the crane revealed a scene of devastation. Most of the shield plugs at the top of the reactor had been violently ejected, while inside the pressure vessel, the uranium fuel elements had melted into a shapeless lump. This indicated a runaway chain reaction had occurred, flash boiling the coolant inside the core and causing a violent steam explosion. More evidence of what had transpired came from a nuclear accident dosimeter recovered from the reactor building, whose gold-197 sensing element had been partially transmuted into the radioactive isotope gold-198. A brass watch band recovered from Burns and a cigarette lighter screw from McKinley were also found to contain radioactive copper-64. Such transmutations could only have been caused by intense neutron bombardment, a hallmark of a runaway reaction. Finally, the reactor building was heavily contaminated with barium-130, cesium-134, iodine-131, all fission products produced by the splitting of uranium nuclei. Due to the large workload and the small size of the night shift crew, there was nobody in the control room to monitor operations or keep a log, so much of what we know about the accident was pieced together from physical clues and experiments performed after the fact. The explosion is believed to have occurred when John Burns, standing atop the reactor, withdrew the center control rod in order to connect it to its electric drive motor. Ordinarily, this operation would only have required the rod to be withdrawn around 10 centimeters, but for some reason, Burns lifted it more than 50. This caused the core to go prompt critical, the power output spiking to 20 gigawatts, 6,000 times the reactor's rated capacity, in only 3.6 milliseconds. This caused the coolant in the bottom of the reactor to instantaneously flash boil, creating a giant steam bubble that propelled the water above it into the top of the reactor vessel at 50 meters per second. This massive water hammer caused the entire 12,000 kilogram reactor vessel to jump nearly 3 meters into the air, and the heavy shield plugs and control rods to be ejected out the top, knocking Burns and McKinley to the floor and impaling Legg to the ceiling. Mercifully, as the water coolant also acted as the reactor's moderator, slowing down the neutrons so they could more easily split uranium nuclei, the loss of coolant immediately caused the reactions to stop. However, the total release of energy was enough to melt the uranium fuel elements, damaging the core beyond repair. But while investigators were able to reconstruct the sequence of events with a great deal of accuracy, one key question remained. Why had John Burns lifted the control rod more than 5 times its critical limit? Almost immediately, rumors began to circulate about possible foul play. In 1962, 1 year after the disaster, an AEC inspector named Leo Miazga wrote a memo accusing Burns of deliberately melting down the reactor in an act of jealousy-driven murder-suicide. According to Miazga, Burns and Richard Legg were bitter workplace rivals who had once gotten into a drunken fistfight at a party. Legg constantly accused Burns of having an affair with a local prostitute and was rumored to have been sleeping with Burns' wife. The memo went on to claim that on the night of the accident, Burns received a phone call from his wife threatening a divorce, causing him to snap and withdraw the control rod to kill both himself and Legg. McKinley, Miazga claimed, was simply collateral damage. Initially classified, this version of events went public in 1979 when another memo by AEC official Dr. Stephen Hanwar was leaked to the Vermont newspaper, the Brattleboro Reformer. The memo stated unequivocally that the accident was, to quote, the result of a murder-suicide committed by one of the operators. But while the story is widely repeated in retellings of the SL-1 accident, there is almost no evidence to support it. Indeed, according to William McCowan, author of the 2003 book, Idaho Falls, The Untold Story of America's First Nuclear Accident, the AEC guys were covering their asses. They didn't want their nuclear program impugned. I don't think they believed much, if anything, they wrote about them. But what they said pissed off a lot of old nuke guys. They felt these men were doing work on a crappily built reactor and lost their lives because of it. And then they get hit with this shitty legacy made up by the bosses. But if not deliberate sabotage, what then caused the explosion? In their official 1961 report, the AEC concluded that the SL-1 incident was indeed an accident, albeit one precipitated by serious design flaws and years of ignored safety warnings. In order to compensate for the reactor's high reactivity, the control rods were fitted with strips of boron, a neutron poison. A neutron poison, boron readily absorbs neutrons, helping to keep the reaction under control. But when boron absorbs a neutron, it splits into non-absorbent lithium and hydrogen, causing the reactions to accelerate. If properly designed, such burnable poisons degrade at the same rate as uranium fuel, keeping the reactor's overall reactivity at a steady level. In SL-1, however, the boron strips had a tendency to distort, causing the control rods to become sticky. Indeed, over the previous 2.5 years of the reactor's operation, 80 instances were recorded of the rods becoming stuck while being inserted or withdrawn. However, the problem was never taken seriously or adequately addressed. Experiments conducted on a mock-up control rod assembly after the accident revealed that if the central control rod had gotten stuck on the night of January the 3rd, it could have caused John Burns to pull harder than normal and accidentally withdraw the rod farther than its critical limit. This simple but deadly flaw was symptomatic of larger-scale safety issues with the SL-1 design. In an attempt to make the reactor as simple and transportable as possible, Argonne National Laboratory had omitted dozens of key safety features found in more conventional designs, with deadly consequences. In the wake of the accident, the stationary low-power reactor project was cancelled, and over 18 months the remains of the SL-1 were dismantled and buried under 4 meters of earth. Today, there are no signs to mark the radioactive debris lying just beneath the desert floor. In total, some 790 Army and AEC personnel were exposed to high levels of radiation during the rescue, investigation, and cleanup operations, though no discernible long-term health effects were observed. And as the explosion was entirely contained within the reactor building, almost no radiation was released into the surrounding environment. While the SL-1 disaster was not the first reactor meltdown in the United States history, as of this recording, it remains the first, and only, to result in immediate deaths.